Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfe here. So recently I was invited out to play Rise of Iron by Bungie and Activision. Spoiler alert, if you have not played Rise of Iron's final campaign mission yet, you should probably go ahead and do that because what we're talking about in this video is very much relevant to that. This is your warning, if you haven't finished it, I would recommend leave now and come back and watch this video later because trust me, this is a moment which you don't want to get completely spoiled with. Now that you've had your warning, let's jump into this. But do keep in mind I have a very special announcement at the end of this video, so be sure to stick around for that. So, what am I talking about in this particular video? I'm talking about this, a new exotic sword, namely the Young Wolf's Howl. The Young Wolf's Howl is an exotic weapon that you can acquire by completing the Rise of Iron campaign. That's the short 5-mission opening campaign, by the way. Not the full post-game questing stuff that you get after you finish that campaign. You only need to do the 5 missions and you will all get this exotic automatically. It is a solar sword, it drops at 340 light and has a lot of the same perks as Ray's Lighter, with but one rather large difference in terms of the actual functionality of it. Take the Ray's Lighter's solar uppercut and replace it entirely. There is a new perk on this weapon. The new R2 perk on the Young Wolf's Howl is known as Howling Flames, and it's a little bit different from your solar uppercut for the following reasons. Yes, it's a heavy solar attack that deals a lot of damage, but for starters, when you do it, it's going to use 10 ammo instead of 5. But what are the benefits of using 10 ammo? Well, looking at it now, back in my gameplay, realize there are some benefits and there are some reasons to use this instead of Ray's Lighter. Number one, the solar explosion has a much larger area than Ray's Lighter's solar uppercut. The solar uppercut is good versus single enemies, whereas this is good versus larger enemies, and also if there's a crowd of 2 or 3 really large bosses, you can potentially hit all of them if they're grouped up right in front of you. I was also able to catch multiple strong enemies in a single blast with this, where the Ray's Lighter's solar uppercut would rarely catch 2. It was kind of a neat little thing, but it's not something I'd rely on. Now, the next really important parts of this are as follows. The explosion stays on the ground and deals damage over time, in a similar way to the Iron Battle Axe that you can get during the campaign and during the patrol missions, etc. You know, this is something which really does make a small difference against those foes that are very stubborn. A really high health Centurion Taken, for example, that's also a major. That's the kind of thing that I think this will make a difference for. And finally, it's the fact that it weakens enemies. This is not something I got to extensively test, but in my experience with this, I actually found that it appears this does a little bit of extra damage. So it's a little bit like the Ignite effect as it got changed with Warlocks. For those of you who don't know, the Ignite effect was changed up so that whenever someone was set on fire, they would take extra damage from all sources. So it's a little bit like the enemy is tethered for a bit. Now, is this effect going to be noticed primarily on lots of targets? No. And the reason for that is quite simple, because they're going to die to the massive damage of the explosion. Does it mean that the Young Wolf's Howl is a little bit more utilitarian than the Ray's Lighter? Yeah, I'd say so. It has better perks for all situations. It's still got the Solar Forged Guard, it's still got really great standard DPS with the heavy swings, and as it stands, swords are the most efficient heavy weapon that you have anyway. Rockets cannot necessarily always deal massive AoE damage, and it's still very much the case that machine guns, unless you're headshotting something, aren't the perfect source of pinpoint DPS. You still want to go ahead and use sniper rifles for that. However, with Young Wolf's Howl, you can be a little bit better against bosses, you can deal with some more AoE, and you get all of this at the cost of having to use 10 ammo. But if you think about the kills you would have been able to get with a clip of heavy ammo from a machine gun, for example, maybe that payoff is worth it. I'm not totally sure, but it's something that's really interesting to experiment with. As for PvP, don't use this sword in PvP. Now, in terms of leveling, this is also something I would equip if I were you, if you're trying to get those progressive blues to level you up. Just because it does drop at 340 when you finish the campaign, it's going to be a very high level exotic for some people. For those of us who grinded all the way to 335 on all characters, it's not going to be such a big deal. But still, something pretty cool if you want to go ahead and level just a little bit faster. And also, keep in mind that with this particular exotic, you will get 2 ornaments. My favorite of these is definitely the Wolves Remember, and that is one that turns it black and gold and gives it this lovely kind of red handle. It makes it much more sort of noble and, well, properly forged. It feels like a weapon that is aged black with the steel. It's great. But then also there's its second ornament, which is Born in Fire, which cracks the blade down the middle and gives it this kind of fiery interior, which is really cool. The lore behind this as well, for those of you who are interested, is very nice. Sadly, this isn't what I was hoping it would be. It is not the Radagast's Blade Reforged, which I was really hoping we would get within this expansion. However, it does signify something very different. Radagast's Blade was something that united the Iron Banner, and as long as it was not broken, essentially the Iron Banner was invincible. Lo and behold, it was broken probably in the fight with Siva. Now, however, there's something even more intriguing with this, because this is the first blade that Saladin will hand you when you finish the campaign, and this signifies the start of a new generation of Iron Lords. We've essentially become the new King Arthur here, and I think that representation with this weapon is pretty cool. Would it still be nice to go back and find Radagast's blade? Maybe go back into the slightly destroyed final boss room for Siva? Hell yeah, I want to go ahead and see that at some point in the future. I think if they don't do this, it's kind of a bit of a missed opportunity, but at the same time, the lore behind this particular sword pertains to our Guardian. It's a real part of our story, just like the swords we got back from Oryx were. So I'm very much happy with this, and also it is a big signifying point about the fact that we are a new generation of Iron Lords, and we are the first of those generations, if you're to take your Guardian as kind of a thing that exists in a vacuum. So yeah, it's very cool. And I will go ahead and just say it right now, I think I'm going to go ahead and try this out in PvE. I feel like it's one of those things where if you did use this in combination with a variety of other swords, such as your Raze Lighters, you might be able to take down bosses even more quickly. It's one of those things that real speedrunners for strikes might want to consider, especially seeing as you can dump a lot of ammo into a target very quickly. The R2 attack, as it uses 10, means that you can do a grand total, I believe, of 7 of those attacks if you've got one of the scabbard upgrades, 9 of them if you've got 2. So it's really powerful in that regard. Either way, definitely go ahead and check this one out. You'll all pick this up at some point after the campaign is finished, so it's something that you'll be able to use. Tell me what you think particularly about how this weapon compares to Raze Lighter. I'd actually be fascinated to see that, because I can see how some people would be a little underwhelmed by this in comparison, and I can see why some people would think it's much better. Personally, I'm on the fence. I think it needs to prove itself to me, but it certainly does look good enough for me to keep it around for the time being. Anyway guys, I'm going to go ahead and let the rest of this mission gameplay just roll out for you. You can see me use a little bit more of the sword in it, and yeah, something nice and cool for you guys to go ahead and observe. But in the meantime, my name is Bife. Prodacia ad astra. I'll see you, Starside.
There are Siva readings pinging all over this region. I'll try to match them against the specific heat signature we found. There. This is definitely the place. Closer look at what's in that cave. This is worst case scenario. The Splicers aren't in a territorial war with the Hive. They're experimenting on them.
And if the Splicer's High Priest is going to these lengths, he's either gone crazy with power, or he's taking orders from someone who has.
Like an Archon?
Or a Prime. Either's bad news. But for now, we've got a clear-cut problem. We need to find this High Priest and put an end to his atrocities.